I was really excited to interview these activists today. And this is pre-recorded, you know, so I won't be responding live, or the interviewees won't be responding live to any comments. But I was really excited to talk to these folks because they're with a group called the SBSLO Alliance. And what it is, here, check this out. Here's a photo of them. What they are is I first came in contact with them at the counter demonstration at the pro Trump event that happened here in Santa Maria, California. You can go back into my into my videos, and I believe the title is "Scuffle at the Trump Rally in Santa Maria, California." And so it's my most viewed video because a Trump supporter, you know, started swinging at one of these activists. And basically they're out there as counter demonstrators, counter demonstrating against, you know, the Trump people. But they also organize in Santa Maria and in other areas of the Central Coast, and in coordination with other groups who you're going to hear mentioned in this interview, they organize mutual aid. And so you might be wondering, what is mutual aid? I'm going to let my guests explain this. But so these groups, these are leftist groups. This one is SBSLO Alliance. There are a bunch of other groups on the Central Coast, Santa Maria Youth Abolitionists and others. They're going to get shout outs there too. But, you know, if you can find them, SBSLO Alliance, on Instagram and on Twitter. And, you know, you look into their follows and you're going to find more of these groups. And they share each other. There's a lot of synergy and cooperation and solidarity between these groups. For now, let's take a look at, let's see here. So I got to bring up the video really quick, but I'm going to show you guys this interview I did today. So this was, again, I was just, it's exciting to see for me, as somebody who grew up on the Central Coast of California during the George W. Bush years, right? You know, leftists organizing in this way and using very, like, strong, deliberate language, not backing down their beliefs and really just backing them up. So check this out. This is an interview. I'll be back after the interview. We're going to talk about a couple more things. Yes, we're going to get to Bernie's mittens. They're fantastic, and all the photos. But right now, check this out. This is two activists who you know, want to protect their privacy. They've already been doxxed. They've already been attacked online and in person, as I've documented. So these two activists shared with me, you know, what the group's about and what they do. So let's check it out. But so I have with me today for the show a couple guests from the local activist group. I'll let you all explain what it is and define it, but SBSLO Alliance. Why don't you tell me a bit about how and why you started this group and what is, like, the mission or what is the point of SBSLO Alliance?
Okay, so this organization was just started this year. A lot of us had been organizing separately with other leftist groups, but we all came together in 2020 to organize a protest outside of the ICE detention center in Santa Maria. And that was right after the Trump administration was threatening to send undocumented students, like, deport them. And they had separated families from children at the southern border indefinitely. So this was an issue that touched, like, all of our hearts, because we are pretty much all in our group descendants of migrants and indigenous people of North America. So we really relate to what it's like to be taken away from your parents and put into a detention center, just like what happened with the missions and the boarding schools where they took away Native American children from their parents. And a lot of people still feel the generational trauma from that, because it was just a few generations ago. And it's kind of happening again to these other Indigenous people who are Indigenous to North America. They're traveling their native continent and they're experiencing their worst nightmare, just trying to come here to work. So, we all actually met while we were organizing a protest for ICE. And there is when we started to work with our other leftist organizations. And I can just define what a leftist organization is really quick.
Sure.
Left-wing politics supports social equality and egalitarianism. Often in opposition to social hierarchy, left-wing politics typically involves a concern for those in society whom its adherents perceive as disadvantaged, relative to others, as well as a belief that there are unjustified inequalities that need to be reduced or abolished. According to a professor of economics, Barry Clark, left-wing supporters claim that human development flourishes when individuals engage in cooperative, mutually respectful relations that can thrive only when excessive differences in status, power, and wealth are eliminated. So we don't have any like leaders in our organization. We're not liberals. We don't buy into identity politics. We want to make the need for the prison industrial complex and the police and police brutality obsolete. We want to be able to provide community care so that people who are impoverished don't need to commit crimes to get by and all that.
I see. So you guys came together to organize a protest, and based on this theory and this these ideals that you have, you started organizing mutual aid. Tell me about mutual aid. When did the group start providing mutual aid, and what kind of mutual aid did the group provide?
Okay, so this definitely came as an afterthought to the protest when we started to meet like more abolitionists, things like that. We decided to collaborate, and that is in order to like serve our individual communities better. So we work with like a few different abolitionist groups, and let me read what I wrote. Okay. So mutual aid is being provided by a coalition of abolitionists and leftist groups all over Chumash land or the Central Coast. We have collaborated with people as far north as Paso Robles and as far south as Ventura County. Our main focus right now is within the less marginalized communities we live closest to. Our next mutual aid event is going to be this Saturday, tomorrow, distributing hygiene kits at the Vons in Napomo. And then on Sunday, we're going to be doing the same thing in Grover Beach, where we do the counter protests. We're going to be giving out like hygiene kits on Oak Park and Grand.
So this is January 23rd and 24th?
Yes.
Okay. Very cool. So the hygiene kits, I know you guys, I think you've done food before, right? And clothing. Mm-hmm. Right. So what exactly is mutual aid, and how, you know, and especially from a left wing leftist perspective, how is this different from just simple charity?
Okay. So that's actually one of my favorite questions, because when I did become a part of this group, I was unaware of what mutual aid was. I thought, hey, I've been doing this my whole life. No, what I was doing was charity. So in mutual aid systems, people work together to meet the needs of everyone in the community. So it differs from charity, which is basically just a one-way relationship between an organization and its recipients. And it often responds to the effects of inequality, but not its actual causes. So I guess like mutual aid is an act of solidarity that builds sustain networks between your neighbors and neighbors in like neighboring communities, neighboring counties, not just like your actual neighbors. Speaking in terms of the rise in community assistance, as a response to this pandemic, mutual aid is not just a response to a crisis. This is stuff we do. Every month, trying to make it something everybody ends up doing for their own community and not just in a response of a crisis or a tornado or any natural disaster, again, the pandemic, but instead it's more of a permanent alliance between people united against a common struggle. So in short, we basically offer help, which could be anything ranging from resources, like you guys said, you listed them off, hygiene kits, food, money, clothes, meals, skills, kind of just driving to go pick up somebody's groceries who isn't able to go do that themselves, especially in the middle of the pandemic, or even the prescriptions, which are then just redistributed into the community who are in need. So mutual aid systems operate the notion that everyone has something to contribute and everyone has something that they need. So
okay. And so also, how is this different from just like government aid? Like is an idea I've heard in leftist spaces is the idea of dual power and just building power outside the government and building power outside traditional charitable groups like that. Why is how you guys target your mutual aid, like how is that different from, you know, we just talked about charity, but also what the government does. I mean, I assume also there's not like forms you're asking people to fill out when you're giving them a hygiene kit or anything like that.
Actually, no. So I used to work at the Homeless Coalition, and okay. There's so many red tape that comes along with like charity. So the people who are distributing things from the Homeless Coalition, they're using the money from federal grants to buy that stuff. So every single thing has to be accounted for. And sometimes people aren't given things that they need just because they're not meeting their standards for getting into permanent housing. And with mutual aid, it's no questions asked. We know it's not just people who are really struggling who need extra help sometimes. It's all of us. And we don't ask questions about what's your income? Do you qualify for this? No, because everybody in the working class is struggling. We understand that even us at times, if we need help, if some of us, like one of our comrades just asked for money to help them with books in school, and all of our organizations, like, we're donating money to that person. I don't know if it was a woman or a man or non-binary person, but like we just come together to give a little of what we have to support one another. And that's different than the charities, because people are getting paid to be there. It's not coming out of their own pockets. And likewise, they can't just give stuff away. They have to have the right paperwork and all of that for when they get audited. But we don't get any grants or anything like that. We're just grassroots. Like our first couple of mutual aid just came like right out of our pockets. We did end up getting, like, after the rise, we got some like donations from community members and stuff that we were able to like buy stuff with. But at first it was just like, we have enough money to feed a few people, and if we collaborate, it could cost us little to nothing. And now it's just like kind of picking up momentum. But really quick, I wanted to highlight some of our comrades who are also doing things on a weekly basis.
Yes, I wanted to ask you about them. But really quick, before we do that, people can find you guys on Instagram and elsewhere at SBSLO Alliance. That's like Santa Barbara, San Luis Obispo County, SBSLO Alliance. Do you guys have a Cash App or address where people can help you guys out and fund some of these endeavors?
Yeah, we do. And it's on our Instagram. I think it's just SBSLO Alliance on Cash App and Venmo. But
I'll make sure to look that up and include it for everybody in the live stream. But go ahead and tell me about these other groups, because that was my very next question was, you guys aren't alone in this. There's a bunch of these left groups across the Central Coast. Very, for me as a you know, a millennial who came up during the Bush years, it's very promising, good news to see across the Central Coast, we have groups of leftists organizing in this type of way.
Yeah, so we have the Santa Maria Youth Abolitionist and Panceta Elena, who distribute breakfast every Sunday morning at 9 a.m. at Buena Vista Park in Santa Maria. So they're there every morning, really bright and early. Their food they've been providing it every morning, but it always runs out. There's always a line. Wow. So if you guys want to donate, please donate to them. Santa Maria Youth Abolitionists, they were probably one of the first leftist groups to approached us to start doing mutual aid too. So they're definitely our comrades. And then Abolitionist Action of the Central Coast distributes boxes of groceries every Sunday at 5 p.m. At the Fallas parking lot in Santa Maria.
Cool.
So they're doing a lot of amazing work, and I would say donate to them. They help us a lot, and they could use the donations because they're doing it every week without missing a beat. They're always out there. So they're really powerful and inspiring to us too.
Very good. And I know one of our interviewees has kids running around, and she's got to come and go with the video. It's not a problem at all. But I want to thank you both for speaking with me today. But last thing, let's talk about, I feel like people understand mutual aid a bit better now, or hopefully they do after watching this. And now they know about several groups and several opportunities to let people in need know where these mutual aid events are meeting. Well, I have a couple things, but before we get to the idea of counter demonstration and some of the stuff y'all have dealt with, because that's where I met you guys, was at a counter demonstration. But before that, some of the messaging that I've seen in the like some of the signs you guys have around some of these mutual aid events, it's stuff I wouldn't expect to see. Or I guess I want to understand you know, what's the inspiration for that? What is the messaging that goes along with mutual aid? Because obviously you have signs saying, come get some hygiene kits, but then there are some other signs as well. Do you want to explain that a little bit to me?
Yeah, I'd love to. So first and foremost, any and all messages can be shared within our group. As Ariel was saying earlier, we're all equals. And if there's anything specific that somebody believes in or wants to share, we got their back and we will support it and we'll display that. So yeah, there are plenty of anti signs posted around. So you'll see anti-religion, anti-church, anti-mission, anti-Junipero Serra. There are a lot of Native youth that are in our group too. So it just amplifies that we're missed to that. So those are basically just representations of accepted racism and accepted in a form of abuse that people are still okay with, like sharing or just constantly trying to push that religion on other people. So I do want to say that, like, I did meet a majority of these people of SBSLO Alliance at the protests against Junipero Serra. So that's where these come from. I think one of the signs that I've seen, one of your videos where you were talking about the fuck the Bible, tax the church. Mm-hmm. That's a real thing, because why are we not taxing the church? Is if they're constantly making a profit from all of the donations. So realistically speaking, missions do sit on burial grounds. Missions were built on stolen Chumash land, especially in California. So being anti-mission is being anti-racist and anti-genocide. So so just bringing awareness and bringing conversations up with those signs is one of our biggest like goals, I guess you can say, when distributing these, because people are constantly like, whoa, why are you so aggressive with that sign? Or, you know, like, what does that sign mean? And it's just, well, we're bringing awareness and we're standing in solidarity with our Native relatives, our Native comrades in this group who don't feel comfortable with that constant reminder of the trauma that their ancestors were put through. Junipero Serra was a rapist and a murderer, and he caused genocide on Native Americans. I mean, missions are, again, burial grounds. So when you go to a mission because of a beautiful landscape, just remember that there are Native Americans who are buried within those buildings and were forced to do that labor. And women were forced to go through their pregnancies of their rapists. And if they were caught getting an abortion, they were basically just publicly shamed. So I'm getting choked up because this is a really touchy subject, but it has to be talked about because these are our truths and this is our history that isn't shared and isn't taught. And the educational department. So if they're not going to do it, if the government isn't going to make the education system step up and teach the truths, then we as people have to do it, because generational trauma is not going to go into my next, like, my next line. My baby, my daughter is not going to have to live with these traumas of seeing Junipero Serra and being reminded of all the atrocities he's caused to me and our people. So,
wow. Yeah.
That's why we're anti all that.
That's fascinating. You definitely have a sympathetic ear, if you want to say tax the church. That has been something I have been for and pro. You know, a lot of people followed the whole new atheism thing years ago, which kind of took a toxic turn with a lot of things as Trump happened. So to see leftist groups that vocally anti-church, but to see where it comes from, like you said, an anti-imperial, anti-genocidal,
colonial.
Yes. Yeah, anti-colonial. And you're holding up a book. Why don't you tell me about that really quick?
Yeah. Okay, so this is the book about Junipero Serra, and it talks about all of the... It's called A Cross of Thorns, and it's really just... It comes from personal writings, and they were really, like, depicted and all that, but it shows about all of the atrocities that were committed in the name of church, and about how indigenous people, like our ancestors, weren't like willfully, consensually working and be joining the missions. They were forced to through violence and through manipulation and through food scarcity and like through theft of the land and through erasing their own culture and demonizing it and making it illegal. None of that stuff is ever talked about. We still have elementary school teachers teaching about the missions in fourth grade. And it's never mentioned that this was forced upon Native Americans, that our ancestors never wanted to have their culture erased. And whenever we bring that up, because we brought that up to the mission, and whenever we do, we're just minimized, we're silenced, we're gaslighted. They say, oh no, that didn't happen. They wanted to be here when they're still living relatives of people who were in the boarding school who remember that they were beaten so badly that they had like infections that grew like maggots in their bodies and stuff like that. So it's real, and we know that it actually happened, and the first step in moving forward from that is understanding it and acknowledging it in order to heal. You cannot just say, oh, I did something bad to this person, and just keep telling them, oh, it never happened. That's psychological manipulation. That really did happen, and we have voices now. It's not against the law to speak against the church like it was in the past. We won't be beaten. We won't be shamed. We won't be looked at as evil. So we're using our voices because previously our ancestors couldn't. And now that we can, we're going to fight for it.
Yeah. Very cool. Going off of that, I'm sorry. I just want to add in there. Going off of that, we will not be silenced. When we were protesting the Junipero Serra statue, we were met with a biker gang from Los Angeles. They're called the Columbus Knights. Mind you, we were in the middle of a pandemic, so this protest was open to like locals from the area. And this biker gang came from all the way from Los Angeles. Every time one of us went up to go speak, in most of the speakers were of Chumash descent, they revved their engines to silence our voices. And they even had, I don't know what kind of horns they were blowing, but they said that they came from Mexico and they were blowing on these horns every time somebody was speaking. So our voices will not be silenced no matter how hard you try.
Wow. No, that's fascinating. That's crazy. Yeah, I remember I saw a video of the Barbareño Chumash at I think Ventura County Building, and they were just having an Indigenous People's Day. It wasn't a a demonstration or anything, and a bunch of people with Trump flags showed up and screamed at them and honked their horns and called them communists. I'm also reminded of years ago, I did some reporting where the California education, Department of Education was kind of like, we're going to try to shy away a little bit from the whole sugar cube models of the missions. Maybe that's not the most important thing to share. But I use that like changing conversation over how the missions are taught in fourth grade to look at the 1811 rebellion of the Chumash, where they overthrew San Ynez La Purisima and Mission Santa Barbara, and they held La Purisima for more than a month, which is interesting. And, you know, I got all this reach out from locals who grew up here who go, never even knew that existed, never knew it happened. And a friend of mine who's Chumash and grew up, he later talked to me and he said, oh, we knew about it. Like we, you know, being a fourth grader in the local schools, like you hear, you're taught this history, but we knew our real history. And, you know, and of course I was met with all the angry backlash of the local right wing calling me a revisionist and, you know, which is a compliment from them as far as I'm concerned. But I find that really interesting. So you guys saw counter demonstrators, and that brings me to the last question. Part of your mission isn't just having demonstrations like that, but I've seen, this is where I met SBSLO. It's my most watched YouTube video, 10,000 views or more, because this Trump supporter started pushing a member of yours and then taking swings at him. Where does counter demonstrating fall into that? Why is that an important thing to do? Why is something that y'all are compelled to do as a group, more beyond just doing your own demonstrations and the mutual aid?
Yeah. To us, counter protesting is just an extension of mutual aid. We do it for people in our community because it's triggering to see people in our community openly and enthusiastically supporting someone who built their whole campaign on being anti-immigrant, anti-indigenous, anti-black, and anti-working class. Our community is filled with migrants whose worst nightmare would be to be deported. They just came here to work, and that's what they do here. They pick our vegetables and they do everything for us. The government stopped providing them proper visas to do so legally, so they are automatically breaking the law. Imagine how it feels to see people who might call immigration on you and your community all the time on your way to work every Saturday morning. They shouldn't have to live their lives in fear. And they can't say anything because they could easily have their lives turned upside down or lose their own children or be deported. So they can't say anything. So we are privileged enough to be able to stand up for our community members, even if they can't. We were born here. None of us are migrants. We are forced to work backbreaking jobs all day. So we're not working in the fields or at restaurants. We don't have to get there at 4 a.m. and stay until 8 p.m. We go to school and we have like regular jobs. So we may not have much, but this is us redistributing our wealth by giving up some of our time to show our community we care. It's not necessarily about creating conflict. It's about showing support for the people they are trying to intimidate. When they see us up there with like the Black Lives Matter flags, the Pride flags, the Abolish ICE flags, the Land Back flags, they know that there are progressive thinking people here who love the people in our community and who the right are bashing, mocking, and further inflicting harm on already hurt communities. Community care is the easiest way to combat the shame that discrimination inflicts. People need to know that they have people who have their backs and a place to belong in this predominantly white area. So yeah, that's why we do it.
Very cool. Well, I want to thank you both for joining me today just to talk about your group and what it does. And like I said, you're not the only group, but it's neat to see the synergy between all you guys. And thank you for mentioning some of those other groups. Is there anything either you can think to add or plug? So guys, I'm going to cut it a little short, and I do plan on posting the full interview as well later. But there you have it, these local activists with SBSLO Alliance. That's for Santa Barbara and San Luis Obispo County Alliance. Very interesting. I really love to see left organizations like this across the Central Coast, like I said in the video, something that I didn't think I would see, growing up out here during the Bush years and, protesting the war and getting stuff thrown at me and not making a lot of, friends doing that. Of course, my friends who I protested with, but very cool. I really appreciate them joining the show. So what did you guys think about that? I thought, organizing mutual aid and how different that is from, charity is super interesting. I hope if you weren't aware that mutual aid was going on in the Central Coast, that you can either get access to it or you can share this with somebody who needs access to it. Or you can support it. A lot of these groups have cash apps. I wasn't able to find their direct cash app online, but check it out. Check out SBSLO Alliance at on Instagram and Twitter. They're also on Facebook. You can also find the Santa Maria Youth Abolitionists. They also coordinate with this group to do, I think SM Youth Abolitionists or Santa Maria Youth Abolitionists. You can find them under that. So, very cool. I have just a couple more segments I want to go over here with you guys. I really appreciate everybody being here. We've had up to 10 people watching at once. We have 8 right now. Thank you. Jay says, good show. Thank you, Jay. Andy says, yeah, that was really good. Thank you so much. This show's made possible by viewers like you, of course. And, please like, subscribe, do all the things you guys already have, I know. But if you're just seeing my show for the first time, my name is Joe Payne. This show is Political Payne. I am a print journalist by trade, but I was always really into video, videography and different stuff. Chewy in the comments here for SBSLO Alliance. It's same username everywhere. Very cool. They're across social media. So connect with them, including the Venmo and Cash App. There you go. Thank you, Chewy. That is the pin we needed in this thing. That was the missing link on Venmo and Cash App, SBSLO Alliance. You can find them on Venmo and Cash App. So very cool. So you can support them directly, and that they will be getting that out to the community. As you can see here, this is some of the mutual aid that they did most recently. That's the Santa Maria City Hall. So that's the hygiene kits and water and stuff they're giving out to the community. I gotta say, I love the tax, the church, and all of this stuff. Seeing anti-religious, anti-church signs and stuff like that is pretty interesting to see. So.